Which is a blessing. Almighty Father, we thank you for your presence in our life. In you we live, move, and find our being. Our hopes all lies in you. We invite you this morning to come and minister to each one of us. Speak inwardly to our hearts. Align our will to serve you. Transform us through the experience of worship, praise, and the hymns, and all the songs that give glory to you. And in our corporate worship, we invite you, God, be true and present, and may you take charge. We pray for our friends who are on the way, that, Lord, you invite them to come and join us in this worship. Be praised and glorified, Almighty God. We thank you, we glorify your name, and we ask all this in the name of God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Praise God. Thank you so much for coming. It's a joy to be before God. Now we'll continue in our worship with a processional hymn.
Oh,
Beloved in Jesus Christ, we thank God for his merciless love and unceasing love for us. Almighty God, this morning we thank you for being true in our life and for your continued works. Without you, we are restless, but in you we find our rest. So, Almighty God, as we worship you, we pray that you work in our life and you draw us to knowing you. Our hope is in the name of the Lord, who made heaven and earth. Together, we have come together as a family of God in our Father's presence to offer him praise and thanksgiving, to hear and receive from his holy word, to bring before him the needs of the world, to ask his forgiveness of our sins, and to seek his grace, that through his Son, Jesus Christ, we may give ourselves to his service. Together, in the inspiration of us, O Lord, as we come to worship, draw us to yourself in prayer and praises, and help us to understand your word through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. You can sit or kneel as we take a moment to reflect upon our life. We are human beings. We live in a fallen world. We are liable to make mistakes. But when we come in repentance to our Lord Jesus Christ, he never delay to forgive us. Let us pray and confess our sins to the Almighty God. Together, Almighty God, we confess that we have sinned in our thoughts, in our words, in what we have done, and in what we have failed to do. We are like lost sheep, unable to help ourselves. Have mercy on us, Lord. Forgive those who confess their faults, as you promised, in Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Almighty God, who forgives all who truly repent, have mercy upon you. Pardon and deliver you from all your sins. Confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in life eternal, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Now, as forgiven children of God, we will join in the Lord's Prayer. Together, our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily food. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Let us praise God for his mercy. Oh Lord, open our lips. Yes, friends, we'll rise up and join the choir in praise and worship.
Good morning, church. You're welcome to this service, and we are going to lift our praises and worship unto the Lord. Hallelujah.
Oh, my dear. Forever, I'll never be the same, 'cause you
and every day we will live for him. Hallelujah. Let me see you clap the hands to the Lord. I know it's a cold morning, but he's worthy of all our praises. Hallelujah.
What say, Lord, you give me life and I can't explain just how much you mean to me now that you've saved me, Lord. Give all that I am to you. Every day I can be alive beside your name. Every day, Lord, I love to stand upon your word.
We live for you every day, every second of our lives.
Thank you so much for what you did for us on the cross. We thank you because in you we have a new identity. We are a new creation. Lord, you've given us a new heart and a new spirit. And so this morning we praise and glorify your name. Receive our praise, O God, because there is no one else like you. Oh,
our seats and take this moment to think back how far the Lord has brought us, and raise up your voice, lift up your voice to Him in thanksgiving, with gratitude. The fire has brought you. As students, some of you are already in third year. The courseworks He allowed you, the good health He gave you, the provision of tuition He gave you, keeping your family back at home, that has been God. Raise up your voice in thanksgiving, in your own word. Those of us with families, with children, His provision has not been short. His gift of life, His wisdom upon us. The Lord has been with us in every instances. Even in difficult time, He has been with us. Let us thank Him that He has even allowed us to be here this morning. Many have preferred to remain in their bed, but we were the ones chosen to come and listen, to come and give thanks to Him this morning. Let us not be like those children of Israel who were not grateful even for the things that the Lord did for them. Even releasing them from slavery in Egypt, they were only looking at the food that they were eating. They were not grateful that they were removed from the kind of life they were living. Let us be grateful and thank Him for who He is, for the far He has brought us, and for the far that He can still take us. Lord, we thank You this morning that You are grateful, that You are sovereign over all circumstances. And we come to You with gratefulness, with confidence, knowing that You hear us and You answer our prayers. Sometimes, because of the trouble that we pass through in this world, we are ungrateful. We only look at the problems that we pass through, and we forget that You are with us in every time. And we forget that You promise that when we believe in You and we ask for anything, You will always come by. We thank You, Lord, for Your offer that You offered us, Your Son, Jesus Christ, who has given us hope. Hope to live, hope to come to You with boldness. This morning we come to You and we pray for our nation, Uganda. We pray for wisdom and discernment for our leaders, especially at this time that most political minds are tuning to 2026 election. We ask that, Lord, in all their preparation, they will promote peace, they will promote prosperity for all citizens. May Your peace reign in every corner of the land. And may there be unity and reconciliation among the people who feel left out. May reconciliation prevail among different communities, among different ethnic groups, among different parties in the nation. Father, we don't forget to pray for our church. We lift up the Church of Uganda. We lift up the leadership from the Archbishop, the bishops, down to the laities. Father, we pray for spiritual revival and deepening of faith among believers. We pray that You strengthen her pastors, her leaders, her missionaries, as they serve Your people in spreading the gospel. We pray that You grant unity, love, and harmony within the body of Christ, that we may be a shining as light in the world of darkness. That, Lord, we shall not compromise the gospel. We shall speak the gospel of truth. We continue to pray for our youth, those who are in school, those who have completed school. We pray that they may be a source, they may be empowered to reach full potential and to contribute positively in their community. Protect them from negative influences and guide them in making wise choices for their future. Raise up leaders among the youth who will lead with integrity and serve their generation with compassion and the fear and the knowledge of You. Dear our Heavenly Father, comfort those who are suffering in different ways, those who are suffering physically, those who are suffering spiritually. We pray that you heal them. Heal the sick. We continue bringing before you your maidservant, Mrs. Dorothy Kalenjo, who has been for some time sick. We pray for Mrs. Ketupito and others we have not mentioned. We have not got their names here, but Lord, you know them. We pray that may you reach them with your right hand of healing. And we continue thanking you for the work you have so far done in their lives. But we continue asking that, Lord, may you reign over their lives and may your mercy be upon them. We pray that you provide and you comfort those who are taking care of them at this time. That, Lord, they will look unto you for anything that they need. That they will not lose hope because you are the God who gives us hope. That healing, treatment is in the hand of doctors, but healing comes from you. We thank you for our families. We thank you for different families that are represented here. Lord, we pray for blessings upon our families. We pray for provision upon our families. We pray for our children who are back home. Lord, there are those that have not completed school fees. Even for the students that are here, there are those who have not completed tuitions. But Lord, we thank you that you have kept them here. Lord, during this time of examination, we continue praying that you strengthen them together with their lecturers, that you give them strength at this time. You give them love, oh God. That, Lord, we shall complete the examination and give praise, glory to you. We thank you, Lord, for the preacher this morning, that as you have prepared her to come and speak to us, Lord, we pray that you will use her, that you will speak through her, that, Lord, she will disappear and you will appear in her, oh God. We pray that you open our hearts to receive from her, that, Lord, every distractions of the week, that we shall forget and focus on you. We thank you, Lord, and bless your holy name. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, we pray. Amen.
Let us stand and we join in Psalm 6 reading. We will read together. Together. O Lord, rebuke me not in your hunger, nor disciple me in your wrath. Be gracious to me, O Lord. Once out of trouble. My soul is greatly troubled, but you, O Lord, how long? Turn, O Lord, deliver my life. Save me for the sake of your steadfast love. For in death there is no remembrance of you. In Sheol will give you praise. I'm weary with my mourning. Every night I flood my bed with tears. I drench my couch with my weeping. My eye wastes away because of grief. It grows weak because of all my faults. Apart from you, weeping. The Lord has heard me. All my enemies shall be ashamed and greatly troubled. They shall turn back and be put to the in a moment. Glory be to the Father, to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, as now, ever shall be, world without end. Amen. Please take your seats.
Our reading this morning is coming from the book of Numbers, Numbers chapter 11, reading begins from verse 1. Numbers chapter 11, reading begins from verse 1. And the people complained in the hearing of the Lord about their misfortune, and when the Lord heard it, his anger was kindled, and the fire of the Lord burned among them and consumed some outlying parts of the camp. Then the people cried out to Moses, and Moses prayed to the Lord, and the fire died down. So the name of that place was called Taberah, because the fire of the Lord burned among them. Now the rabble that was among them had a strong craving, and the people of Israel also wept again and said, "Oh, that we have meat to eat. We remember the feast we ate in Egypt that cost nothing, the cucumbers, the melons, the leeks, the onions, and the garlic. But now our strength is dried up, and there is nothing at all but this manna to look at." This is the word of God. Thanks be to
God. We stand for him led by the choir and how it can be. Please let us stand and join the choir. now affirm our faith in the triune God using the Apostle Creed. Together, I believe in God, the Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, His only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, and was buried, descended to the dead. On the third day, He rose again. He ascended to heaven and is seated at the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of sins, the forgiveness of sins, and the Lord's body, and the life everlasting. Amen. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Show us your constant love, O God. O Lord, save our president. Let your ministers be clothed with righteousness. O Lord, make your ways known upon the earth. Give your people the blessing of peace. Create pure hearts in us, O God. For the collect of the, today, we are on the third Sunday in Easter. Jesus appeared to his disciples at the Sea of Tiberias after he has risen from the dead. Let us pray. Almighty God, whose Son Jesus Christ is the resurrection and the life of all who put their trust in him, raise us, we pray, from the death of sin to the life of righteousness, that we may seek the things which are about, where he reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
Praise the Lord. Good morning. The Lord is good and all the time. Yes, let us thank him for his goodness. Together with me, let us thank the choir for leading us this morning. And I welcome all of you. Thank you so much. Though it is cold, you've taken time to come and worship this morning. Let us thank ourselves. And I take this time to welcome the visitors. If you are worshiping with us for the first time, please, you can stand and we welcome you. Visitors? Okay, today we don't have visitors. Oh, thank you so much. Thank you for coming. Take that as your seat whenever you're still here with us. Maybe there are those who celebrated their birthdays and anniversaries within the week. Please, we want to share a blessing with you. You can put your hand or stand. Stand, we sing a blessing together with you. Birthdays, babies of the week. Oh. Women didn't give birth in the week. Yes. We continue announcing that Life Ministry Uganda has organized the second week to remember, which will take place from 31st May to 3rd June 2024. The early bird has already paid the 1 million by 31st of March. And the pay still remains 1,200,000. Please plan to join. On the 28th April, we shall be celebrating Mary's Day here at Thornycroft Chapel, Chagwe. Those who wish to enroll for Mother's Union should register with the secretary, that is Mrs. Diana Katusime, or any committee member. If you know, there will be a luncheon at a fee of 50,000 per couple and 25 1,000 per person. And then the venue will be communicated within the time, with time. This is our giving for last Sunday, 7th, and also within the week. Offertory was 1,880,400 shillings. Tithe was 245,000. Sunday school was 197,400 shillings. Kampala campus giving was 61,500. Thanksgiving was 889,000. And then special Holy Communion service was 18,000. Eastern Fellowship of UCU Mukono has organized an evangelistic mission to Mbale Diocese in Nabomale Archdeaconry from 20th to 23rd, 2024. Departure will be on Saturday, the 20th, at 7 a.m. at the chapel parking. There are still 4 vacancies for missioners. Those interested in joining, please contact Esago David or Reverend Ronald Makoba. Please take this as a serious note. This morning, our preacher is Dr. Canon Kedrace Turyagyenda. Please, Canon, you're most welcome. We pray that the Lord uses you. Let us welcome her. But, yes. Okay, thank you so much.
So Dr. Kedrace comes, let us stand up and give our offering using the African praise. Thank you so much, girl.
Hallelujah. The Lord is good and all the time. So let's cheerfully and joyfully offer unto him for his faithfulness unto us and for who he is, that he never changes through the ages.
Yamhachi, yes, Yamhachi, Yamhacha, come What can we ever give to the Lord to thank him? Let us close our eyes in prayer as we enter this part of our service. Father, we just can't give you anything. You have loved us so much from past eternity, when you saw us completely lost, condemned for hell, unable to get ourselves there in that dungeon of darkness, stuck. You broke our chains. You provided light for us, and we got out of it as you went on that terrible cross of Calvary. So we thank you. We honor you, Lord, this morning. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Good morning. Praise the Lord. It's a cold morning, but it's a great day, isn't it? This is the day. Let us rejoice. Hallelujah. Let me hear how UCU rejoices. This is the day. This is the day that the... If you have your hands, clap them. If you came with them, clap them. We will rejoice and be glad in it, and be glad in it. This is the day that the Lord has made. We will rejoice and be glad. This is the day. This is the day that the Lord has made. Hallelujah. She's told you my name. Canon Dr. Kedrace Turyagyenda. Nalongo. I am married to Canon Henry Turyagyenda. We are both retired. We have adult children and 3 grandchildren. I want to thank the Lord so much for today. Coming back to UCU for me is a great thing. I was a member of council for 8 years, from 2006, around there. And actually, I was the first chair of the Students Affairs Board. So most of the guidelines and policies were what we passed in our time. I saw a lot of these things coming up. The 2 councils that I was on built the playground, the library, and other things. So I come back, and I feel I'm coming back home. But I'm also excited when I come back that a lot has since happened. I want to thank God for the improvements of UCU. Of course, you know our vision. Center of excellence in the heart of Africa. So I see even the external environment coming to that, and I get excited. I hope you are. Students of UCU, I hope you are in the university, which is a center of excellence in the heart of Africa, the whole of it, from Egypt down to South Africa. Praise the Lord. So it's a great joy for me to be here and to be able to share with you in this service. I thank the chaplain for the invite, and I bring you greetings from my family. My husband is currently in Kabale. Retired people have more than one home. So he's sometimes here when Kabale brings you greetings. I got All Saints Cathedral. I am what they call the people's warden, or the head of laity of All Saints Cathedral, Kampala. I bring you greetings from All Saints Cathedral. I do attend the 8 o'clock service. It used to be 7:30 like yours, but now it's 8. And sometimes when I'm coming back home, I meet a big crowd of young people around Rugogo, you know, where ShopRite used to be. And police stop us in cars because a big crowd of young people have to cross the road, and a series of taxis are there waiting to carry young people. And in my heart, I keep thinking, I hope some of these young people are not from UCU. Every time, because they are coming from Fanero, they have that service down there. So every time I get there, I feel in my heart, I hope none of these come from UCU. Because I don't expect you, who have all the privileges of listening to the truth, getting out to listen to have truth. If you have friends who are going there, keep reminding them they are living the truth at UCU to go and listen to half truth. Half truth has falsehood and falsehood leads to danger. So please make sure that you encourage your friends to make every opportunity, take every opportunity that you see you to learn more about God and how to walk with him and what he expects of you so that you are not deceived. We are living in the last days and there are so many deceptions. And a lot of them seem to be so real that if you don't know the whole truth, you can easily be caught up there. So I'm praying that UCU is not one of the culprits of the Fanero and other groups that have come up. Now, our theme for today is coming from the portion that was read for us from Numbers chapter 11. And it's they have coined it to read, dealing with the pull back to Egypt, dealing with the desire, with the craving to go back to Egypt. When I received this theme from Harriet, I thought to myself, what exactly do I say in that service? And I felt the Lord saying to me, first do what these days at weddings they call, what do they call it? A memory rain. Have you been to weddings? And then they tell you, now watch the screens because we are going to have the memory lane. And usually they would show you the bagole when they were little babies, and then they would show them to you at secondary school playing, and then they would show you the bagole at university with friends, and then they would now show you the bagole. So I thought I would have a quick run in the memory lane that leads us and gives us context to what we are studying this morning. So I'll do a quick run. I know that you know these stories, so I'll not take a lot of time on them, but I thought we needed that context to make sense of this chapter that we have read. First of all, you and me know that when God had created everything on earth, he created human beings in his own image. He breathed his spirit into Adam, and Adam became a living being. And you have come here today, I know that you know God's attributes. You know that God is infinite. He never dies. Hallelujah. You know that God is love, he's holy, he's righteous, he is good, he is compassionate, he's forgiving, he's generous, he's powerful and mighty. We have just prayed, Almighty God. He's almighty, he has all might, all power belongs to him. He is faithful, he's faithful. You saw David crying to him in that psalm that we read. He is wise, he's all wise, he knows everything. He's omniscient, he knows everything. He's omnipotent, he has power to do all things. And this God of ours is merciful and gracious. And so, to be created in the image of God means that we acquired some of those attributes from creation. What a wonderful thing. And you know that also God is a decision maker. And so, he created man in his own image with a free will, with the capacity. We are not like animals that work by instinct. We have the capacity to think, to reason, to churn out things. That's why you do research, so that you can compare your ideas with what others have written. And then after that, you are able to make a rational decision. And we call that free will. So we can make choices. Today, this morning, for example, you chose to come to chapel. You chose to put on what you are wearing. We can make choices because we have that right from creation. When you look at the beginning, man lived in a state of perfect harmony in nature. Man was free of sin. Man was free of pain. Man was free of death. Because man was created in the image of God, he was supposed to live eternally. And God gave him guidelines on how to maintain that relationship. And part of the guideline was, please eat everything in the garden. I've made provisions for you, except on two trees. One, the tree of knowledge and evil. The second one, the tree of life. Otherwise, enjoy everything. Live, multiply, govern the world, be in charge. Hallelujah, what a great thing God has done for us. But when we go down to chapter 3 of Genesis, we read that man decided to use his freedom of choice. He decided to use his free will to choose to disobey God. So he disobeyed, not because he was coerced, but because he decided, because he knew. He knew the instructions, they were clear. He had lived with them for a while in the garden. But man chose to disobey God. Now, when you make a choice, there are usually outcomes of that choice. Sometimes we call those outcomes consequences. If you make a good choice, the outcome is nice, isn't it? If you choose a good university like UCU and you work very hard, the outcome is clear. Because the workers out there of UCU who took up the UCU spirit and vision are different and they are looked for. So when you choose UCU and you choose to really be embedded in UCU, pick the values, learn what is taught, not only in class but also in the community hour and other places, you come out a different, you graduate. But if you choose as a student to sleep, not do coursework, not attend lectures, just go for discotheques in the weekend, you know what the consequences would be, isn't it? Yes, you'd get poor grades. You may even be discontinued. The consequences. So man chose to disobey God. Three great things happened. One, our relationship with God was broken. Because God is holy, God is righteous. Man had sinned so the two could no longer live in fellowship. And man tried to hide away. You remember the story in chapter 3. But the second one was that pain, sickness, sin, and death entered the world. Because God had told him, when you eat, you die. He ate and death came into the picture. But because man had sinned and rebelled against God, which the Bible calls sin, man was now liable for judgment. He was condemned for judgment. He could no longer inherit the great blessings of God. And we've said this in the song that we sang. This morning, incidentally, every morning when I wake up, a song drops in my heart. And the one which dropped in was "How and Can It Be?" And I love the fourth and fifth stanza. Long my imprisoned spirit lay there. In bondage of sin. When I first sang it in my secondary school, we would be reading these little novels where you are reading about a novel where there's this big dark tunnel and there are frightening things in there. And that, whenever I sing that stanza four, that's what I feel. You are right there in a dungeon. You are caught up in bondage of sin. And then you see a ray of light coming through. You see a ray of light coming through that tunnel. And then you get up to follow the ray of light. And when you get up, your chains break. Hallelujah. Your heart is free. And then you walk through the dungeon. And it is all framed with light of Christ. I love it. And so you go the next one, of course. And because of that, no condemnation. Hallelujah. So thank you, choir, for singing those great songs. So anyway, because of our sin, condemnation came in because God is righteous, he's holy, he doesn't compromise his standards, and so man was now destined for destruction unless man could repent. But over the years, the centuries, there were people, because of the God beat in us, we are under the bondage of sin on earth without Christ. But we still have that bit of godliness in us. And so over the centuries, some people would come out of their generation and trust God and walk according to his principles. One of them is Enoch. There's a man called Enoch in Genesis chapter 6, verses 13 to 22. And it says that this man, chapter 5, verse 22 to 24, this man walked with God in holiness. He decided not to be part of what was happening. And the scriptures say God took him. He didn't die. He was not buried here. He walked with God and God took him. Enoch. The second one to remember is Noah. In the days of Noah, man had done every wickedness you could think of. And God was determined to completely wipe out the whole earth with all animals. But Noah had walked in righteousness. And so he was saved from the flood. Chapter 6, verse 13 to 22. Then later on in chapter 12, God looks down from heaven again and he identifies a man called Abraham. He was living in his own community, a pagan family, pagan environment, but he had the fear of God. So God comes and calls him, and Abraham trusts him. That's what we call faith, and obeys God, and he decides now to walk with God. And God calls him, come out of your people, and he tells his wife Sarai, pack your little bags, his nephew Lot, let's go, God is calling us. Where are we going? I don't know, but God has called me. And so Abraham was a friend of God, and God reckoned that as righteousness, and God made a covenant with him in chapter 12, and he said, I'll bless you, and through you, the whole world will be blessed. Hallelujah. Now, from Abraham, he gets a son called Isaac, and his son called Isaac gets twin boys, Jacob and Esau. But through Jacob, God continues with his covenant with Abraham. He produces 12 sons. You read all that in Genesis. And the 12 sons of Jacob had a son, one of them called Joseph, and he's special. He dreams dreams. God shows him things in dreams. And he was a young boy, just 17. And he shares dreams, and his brothers hate him, and they are jealous of him. They sell him off. They want to kill him first of all, then they sell him off. And he goes to Egypt. And for 13 years, he's a slave and a prisoner. But he trusts God. He says, I cannot sleep with you, Potiphar's wife. I can't sin against God. He's set to be righteous. He's set to do what God wanted him to do. And now, Joseph, after 13 years in Egypt, God picks him up and lifts him up and makes him a prime minister of Egypt. And at that time, Egypt was kind of the America of today. It was the greatest nation in the world. It was feared. It had great systems. And so Joseph becomes a whole prime minister. And he's in charge of, I think, those who do procurement call it something. He's in charge of the procurement because the dream he interprets for Pharaoh shows 7 years plenty, 7 years famine. And Pharaoh said, now, you are the man who has seen this thing, please do it. And Joseph does it, and they have grain when the whole known world was in famine. It's against this that Jacob and his remaining sons moved from Canaan to Egypt. Because our topic is, how do we resist the pull back to Egypt? And I thought I would take us in that memory lane to see where to place Egypt in our sharing. So, Jacob, very old man, and his 11 sons now, they moved to Egypt because they had discovered Joseph was there. He had found favor with Pharaoh, and Pharaoh said, bring your family, it's okay. They are 70 in number. They leave Canaan with their herds, and they go to Egypt. And they live in Egypt for a long time. And while they are there, they give them a good land in Goshen. They settle there. They produce. They multiply. Their flocks increase. They study. They progress. They become powerful people. For about 400 years, they are happy. They are immigrants, but they are happy. Then a certain fellow comes whose name is not given. He's unnamed. And he feels so insecure with these immigrants who seem to prosper, who seem to be doing things different because they are people of the covenant of God. And so he says, let's try and finish them off. He enslaves them. He puts them to hard labor. He tells them, you have to work very hard, do bricks, make these big pyramids, build these cities, two cities they were supposed to build. He harasses them. He realizes that that harassment is not working. They are still happy people. They are still progressing. Then he says, no, Let us now kill all the boy children who are born. If all the boy children are killed, when the old men are finished, there will be no nation. But God intervenes. He works through some two midwives, and they keep protecting and not killing the boys. And it's around that time that Moses was born. So Moses is born at that time, hidden from killing, and eventually he lands in Pharaoh's home as an adopted son. God brings him in to understand the ways of Egypt because he was preparing him to rescue his people from this bondage into freedom again. Hallelujah. God has the whole plan for your life. He had the whole plan for his nation that came from Abraham, his friend. He knows. He is in charge. Let us trust him. So the time comes and Moses has run away because he tried to save his people, and they discovered, they knew that he had killed the Egyptian. He runs away into exile for 40 years. He's there, herding sheep, imagine. The one who was brought up as a princess, the son of the princess, who was being served by servants and, you know, moving on donkeys. Now he's there, 40 years in the wilderness. But God was preparing him for the very reason that he spared him from death, to rescue his people from bondage. Moses is a form of Jesus, the one who comes by God's sending and rescues God's people from slavery into freedom. Praise the Lord. And so he goes there, and you know how Pharaoh resisted. That Pharaoh was very tough. He resisted. He said no, until God dealt with him 10 plagues. The plague of the Red Sea turning into blood. Egypt, it's a dry land. It's a desert. They depend on our Nile here. And the Nile now became blood. No water, no nothing. Pharaoh still resisted. He said, I'm not letting you go. God sends frogs. They go into Pharaoh's house, Pharaoh's bedroom, all his officers. They die there. They start smelling. He says, okay, now let's come and discuss. When that is over, he still says, I'm not letting you go. And then he sends gnats, lice. the rooms and people's homes are just infected. Even that, they don't listen. He sends flies. Flies are everywhere. You can't eat food. You can't sleep. You can't do anything. Flies, they reject. Then he sends death into their livestock. The camels, the donkeys, they all die. Pharaoh is still not budging. Then he sends hail. The hailstorm comes and completely devastates the place. Pharaoh is still stuck. He sends locusts. They eat all the green leaves. Finish. He's not allowing them. He sends darkness. Can you imagine having a week of darkness? No light. Darkness. You can't move. You don't know what to do. He still resisted. But finally, God dealt with him severely and caused death for all the firstborns of all Egyptians, all of them. Firstborn of people, firstborn of animals. Can you imagine if you are a firstborn? You have a son with a firstborn who now has a grandson with a firstborn. You all die in one night. This God punishes rebellion. This God punishes sin. He's loving, he's kind, he's gracious, but he's just. When there is breaking of his laws, when there is sin, he punishes. So anyway, after that, now Pharaoh says, I'm finished, I'm done. Go, 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 go. So they set out of Egypt, the young children, the grandmothers, the old men, with their herds, and they move, and they are going to the land God promised their grandfather, the land of Canaan. What a joy. These ones who have been working very hard, being beaten by bad masters, they now say goodbye to them, and they are walking into freedom. God opens the Red Sea, and they walk through the Red Sea. When I would be reading that Red Sea thing, and you see on the map, it's like a strip. I would think it's a strip. It's not a strip. One time I was in a meeting in Egypt at the Red Sea, the venue was at the Red Sea. And the first thing I did when we came out of the bus, I wanted to see the Red Sea. It's a sea. You can't see where it ends. It's a huge stretch. And I stood there at the bank and I thought, God, Moses just lifted his rod and this whole sea, it's a sea. Yeah? You know a sea. Huge extent of water. And I was standing there imagining that this water obeyed God and parted ways, and his children walked on dry ground in the Red Sea. They got the other side. Miriam was a singer. She composed songs. Moses also sang. They praised God who had delivered them from bondage, who had taken them through the Red Sea. Now that's a comparison to us. Jesus has sent his son, the Lord Jesus Christ, and through his death on the cross, he has broken the power of Satan. In Colossians chapter 2, verse 13 and 14, it says, he disarmed at the cross, he disarmed all principalities of Satan and all powers, and he made a perfect public show of them on the cross. So on the cross, he completely broke the chain of sin. He completely broke the bondages of Satan and his wicked spirits, and he set us an opportunity for freedom. And the Red Sea represents baptism. And baptism means death. Death to the old nature as you pick up the new nature. And so they had been delivered. They had been saved. They had been even taken through the Red Sea, a baptism. They were progressing. Excuse me. Some water, please. They were progressing to the promised land. Friends, I'm sure that some of us have said yes to Jesus. When you did that, your chains fell off. Your heart was free. You walked through the dungeon, and now you are going to heaven. Hallelujah. And so as we move between salvation and when we see God face to face, there are a number of challenges. These people who had been rescued from bondage, from slavery, from beating, from killing their children, who have been taken, who have seen all these miracles, they are walking towards Canaan. They start getting challenges. They can't find water in the desert. Then they complain. And here, the portion that we are looking at, turn with me back to Numbers. Numbers 11. The memory lane is over. Now we are at the wedding. We are looking at the real Bagole. How are the Bagole like? In verse 1 of chapter 11. And the people did what? And the people complained. And the people complained in the hearing of the Lord about their misfortunes. Huh? They have completely forgotten. There's a song they sang in the first beat, which was saying that I would never forget. You remember that song? I was so delighted when you sang it. These people did what? Forgot, and they started complaining. They complained in the hearing of the Lord about their misfortunes. And when the Lord heard it, what happened? His anger was kindled, and the fire of the Lord burnt among them and consumed some of the outlying of the camp. When we forget what God has done for us, when we forget that we were condemned for destruction apart from Christ's death on the cross, when we forget the pain he went through, I'm sure 2 weeks ago, during the Passion Week, you went through the whole season of Jesus' pain. the beating, the scourging, the mocking, the spitting on him, everything, he kept quiet. He said, Kedrace is there, John is there, Esther is there. If I don't go to the cross, they will be condemned to hell. I want to save them. The nails, the sin that he carried from us all caused his father not to be in fellowship with him. The cry he made, my father, why have you forsaken me? And out of all that, he bought us salvation. It's finished. The bridge is now there. The sinners can walk to the Father. The blood will wash them clean. They will be children of the Most High. Hallelujah. But sometimes we forget. And we start complaining and we start murmuring among ourselves. Ah, me, I don't like you, see you. All these rules they put on us. Me, I don't like these lectures. Me, I don't like this food. Me, I don't like this, you know? And yet at some point you are saying, I wish I could join university. Just join. But when you are there, you start complaining. And some of people who are working here, they were saying, God, if I could get a job, if I could get a job. And then God opened the door for a job. And then the first month, you're excited, you've got a job, sent a text message to some friends, you know, I now have a job, I have an address. And then you go to Kampala and you meet some of your friends there from Makerere, maybe whose salaries have been raised through science or whatever. And then you start saying, but you see you also. You see you. The employment terms of you see you and the amount of work that we have to do. I know you do a lot of work. I was here for 8 years as council. I know. It is very easy to start complaining. You forget some of you who are working here prayed and even fasted. You know, some people go to mountain to pray. They are looking for a job. When they get it, they do what? They complain. May God forgive us. And the scripture said, in God's hearing, when we complain, God is hearing. And you see, when he heard, because he's righteous, he was not appreciated what he had done, what they had seen, what he did to Egypt for their sake. They had completely forgotten, and they were just complaining. So they complained. They forgot God's mercy, they forgot his grace, they forgot his deliverance, they forgot his protection, they forgot his provision. By this time, they were already getting manna every single day. They would go out and pick and come and cook. They had completely forgotten, and they started, may God forgive us for complaining. When you look then at verse 4, now, the rubble. I was trying to find out what that rubble is, and I discovered that this was a group of people who were not Israelites. But because they had seen what the God of the Israelites did, some were Egyptians and some were other people. So they decided to follow them. They decided to follow them, and so they walked with them. They kind of said, we now believe in the God of these people. Let us remain part of their company. So they followed them, and the Israelites, you know, didn't care. They continued with them. Now here, they are leading the team of complainers. Look at verse 4. Now, the rubble that was among them had a strong craving. Eh? A strong craving. A craving. Because they are in Egypt where they lived. They used to do whatever they did. A craving for the certain foods. And so, they had a craving and they said, they started talking about it. And because they were part of this group that was moving, see the second sentence. And the people of Israel also joined them. They also wept again and said, oh, that we had meat to eat. Oh, that we had meat to eat. They had forgotten how their children, the sons, were being murdered at birth. They had forgotten the strippings from those taskmasters. They had forgotten the Red Sea parting for their sake. And they joined this group of non-Jews. They joined this group, these friends whom we don't want to let go. But they were my classmates. Yeah, but now we are going out for an outing. You call it what? Jazzing, whatever it's called. We want to go and jazz. I want to jazz off with my friend, you know. They were with me in high school. you brought them and kept them into your life, friend, they are going to be a source of danger for you. So these guys, they started with their cravings, they started complaining, and the Israelites also joined in and wept and said, oh, that we had meat to eat. Then in verse 5, we remember the fish that we ate in Egypt that cost us nothing. And then the cucumber, you know cucumber? It is tasteless. I've just known it because we didn't have it. It has just come to market. Oh, we ate cucumber. And what else did they eat? Melons, eh? Watermelon, imagine. Melons. Oh, we had melon there in Egypt when our husbands and sons were being beaten for building the city. For us, we had melons. So we want melon. And then leeks. You know leeks? Leeks are like onions. They are just greens anyway. They are like onions. Leeks. And then onions and garlic. Huh? And garlic. They said when we ate those, we had strength. Now our strength is gone because we don't have them. Forgetting the major and focusing on the minor is extremely dangerous. Let us keep the major as major and the minor as minor. It is true, these ones were not in the wilderness, but they had food. They had manna from heaven. Every day, the food came. But they forgot, they joined their non-believer friends, and they started complaining. So as Paul says in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 33, bad company ruins good morals. Let us learn to separate ourselves from those who don't know Christ. Love them, have them as friends with a mission to bring them to Christ, but don't conform to their standards. We are in the world, but not of. That is John 17, I think, verse 15. We are in the world. Yes, we are part of them. We are all studying same courses, law, BBA, whatever it is. But we are not part. When they start complaining about lecturers, don't join them. When they start complaining about coursework, ah, you see with its coursework. We have to do coursework, set two, and all these things. Ah, you see with its attendance rules, I'm sure they are still there. You have to do 75% minimum to sit exams, isn't it? Is it still there? Yes. And then they say, ah, others in other campuses, they have time to really relax and be campusers. Here we are. Don't join them. Don't join. Those are minors. The regulations are meant to help you come out as an excellent product. Hallelujah. So they complained. They were dissatisfied. They focused on dissatisfaction. When you focus on what you don't have, instead of focusing on what you have and thanking God, you become a miserable person. Because the more you get, the more you want. The more you get, the more you want. So don't focus on what you don't have. Focus on what you have. Thank God for it. Trust Him for what you don't have. They were not there. They forgot, they started complaining, they focused on very little things, really minor things, which I'm sure during those days of the plagues, they also disappeared. But that's where they focused. They also had a sense of entitlement. Young people these days have a very high sense of entitlement. This should be done for me. They deserve this. Why are they treating me like this? Why are they stressing me? And why are they what? And they had a sense of entitlement. They thought they should be treated better. This God who got them out of Egypt should treat them better, should give them the leeks and also the melons. He should give them the cucumber. Why shouldn't he? Why is he just giving them manna? Sense of entitlement. Instead of looking at the wonderful things around us, we keep crying. Here at universities, many young people fall for the six C's. You know them? You know the six C's? Yes, the chips, the chaps, the chapat, the chicken, the cell phone, and the cars. So you are a very nice Christian in Scripture Union in school. You come to your campus and people are offering these C's. Let me take you out for chips and chicken. And then you follow and then you start complaining. These people also, they think that me, I don't have a stomach. Am I not like others? Friends, tomorrow you would have excreted the chips and chicken and you are still the same, but you may have fallen in danger. So let us watch out. How do we keep course? How do we keep focused and we are able to overcome? And that is our last bit, which is the theme for our sharing. How do we keep course? How do we keep focused? How do we keep the majors to be the major and the minors to be the minors? I've come up with 10 points and I'll be done. One, we need to appreciate God's love and keep our eyes on the cross. Appreciate his love that caused him to let his only one son die for you. Remember that without that, you, like the rest of mankind, were destined for the wrath of God, as Paul tells the Ephesians in chapter 2, verse 3. So appreciate God's love. Focus your eyes and your heart and your everything on God's love. You'll be amazed. Secondly, cut links with those who are not on your mission. Their mission was to go to Canaan, a land flowing with milk and honey. Cut links, these rabble who are now complaining and causing them to complain, don't be part of them. When you are with them, be preaching to them the good news. The third is that we should develop an attitude of gratitude. It's not natural in us. We find it easy to complain. You have to commit, develop an attitude of gratitude. Paul tells the Thessalonians in 1 Thessalonians 5, verse 16 to 18. And he says, friends, now that you have found life in Christ, rejoice always. Pray constantly. Keep in touch with the Father. Give thanks in all circumstances, because this is God's will in Christ Jesus for you. Develop an attitude of gratitude. Commit to give thanks in all circumstances. Even when they are difficult, even when you don't understand, say, thank you, Lord, for where I am. I know that you are there with me. Hallelujah. Four, stop grumbling and complaining. Hey, Ugandans, we complain. I'm about to stop watching TV because when you watch it, I mean, you see everything that will make you complain. These MPs have taken these millions of money, and then this, then you come out of your house and it's a pothole and you are falling into it, and then the border person is also crossing, and then there are so many things that can make us complain. But Paul counsels the Philippians in Philippians chapter 2, verse 14 and 15, and he says, do everything without grumbling or complaining, for it is then that you will stand out as lights, as stars in this crooked world in which you live. Let us run away from complaining. When the thought comes for you to complain, repent it straight away. Say, Lord, forgive me. I know you are in charge. Five, learn to be content. Learn to be content. Paul writes to the Philippians in chapter 4, verse 11 to 13, and he says, I know how to have plenty, but I also know how to have nothing. And he says, in all these situations, I have learned to be content. And then verse 13, for I can do all things. We quote it out of context. He was saying, I know how to manage life and still remain content. And so I have learned to do all things, so I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. I'm so thankful to the Lord that I learned this, contentment. I never strive. I had my one shoe for my whole of my O-level. I would have it repaired and repaired and repaired, but I would never complain. I had read this scripture. I told myself I would not complain. I would be content. And because of that, I was saved from all these maftamingi who took my friends out of school, and they are all dead out of AIDS after all. Contentment. Let us learn to be content. If you are able to find your commando, give thanks and be content. Don't strive for the chips and chaps and whatever. Don't. If you have the money, buy it. If you don't have the money, thank God and move on. Contentment. How do we stop ourselves from turning back to Egypt? Let us remember that our being here is by God's grace. And going back to Egypt is going back to bondage. The enemy is waiting. Peter tells the readers in chapter 5, he says, your enemy, the devil, is always there, prowling lying around like a roaring. He wants to bounce on you. The minute you turn off from the grace of God, you are captured. Let us remain in the grace of God. But of course, not the grace that Fanero talks about. That grace which doesn't have righteousness is not grace from God. It's from hell. It's a deception. It's a lie. May God help you to come out and stand strong. Let us daily know what God's mind is. How do we do that? We do that by daily reading God's word, meditating on it, memorizing some of it, and applying it in our lives. As you read God's word and pray, God shows you how to move the next step. If we are to overcome the pull back to Egypt, keep in God's word. Read it daily, meditate on it, and pray. Then, commit to attend regular fellowship. Have a fellowship you are part of. Maybe it's a whole... do you have cells here? Okay. Maybe it's a cell from the hall, or it's a cell from your class, or it's a cell from your course. Whatever it is, have a place of accountability. Have a place of where you know if you are missing, one of them will look for you. Have a place where you can pour out your heart and confess your sins. Oh, today I failed again. I told a lie, but God has forgiven me. And they sing to Kutenderism. Fellowship. As I'm sure all of you have participated in cooking. Some of us grew up cooking with firewood. If you have a fire with firewood, and usually there would be one good firewood, a big piece which is burning well. If you pull it out and put it aside, what happens to it? It goes out, isn't it? Even for charcoal. If you remove this big charcoal that is causing others to burn, and you put it aside, that big charcoal will go, and the small ones will still keep burning. Fellowship will keep you burning. It will keep you on fire for the Lord. It will keep you from going back to Egypt. So please find a fellowship. And second but one, resist the devil. James tells the readers in chapter 4, verse 7, he says, submit yourself to the Lord. Be continuously surrendered to the Lord. Then resist the devil. You will be able to resist the devil when you have submitted yourself to the Lord. Because you are in the Lord, you have the power of the Holy Spirit. Paul tells Timothy in 2 Timothy chapter 1, verse 7, that the spirit God gave us is not a spirit to shrivel back in timidity, but it's the spirit of power and love and self-control. Once you have the, resist the devil who comes through your souls, resist the devil who comes through your attitude, resist the devil. And when you resist, what does he do? He flees from you. And finally, keep your eyes on Jesus, the beginner and the finisher of your faith. Let us keep our eyes on the cross. Let us keep our eyes on the cross. When the devil says, there are leaks that side, you know, there is meat, there is even fish, you will tell him, Satan, I know where I'm going. My Savior is there ahead of me. He's calling me forth. I'll follow. May the Lord help us to stand firm in these crooked times where we live. In this corrupt generation in where we live, he is able to help us to stand. One of the scriptures that I learned early and I still cling on to is Philippians chapter 1, verse 6, and it says that he who began the good work in us will bring it to completion. I got saved at age 12. I was in P6, and the Lord has walked with me this far. The Lord will walk with you until you get gray hair like mine. The Lord will walk with you if you keep your trust in him. When you go back to Egypt, it's destruction. It's destruction, it's enslavement, it's death. When you walk on with the Lord, it gets brighter and brighter as you appreciate his goodness. So may the Lord continue to do that. Let us pray. As we close our eyes in prayer, I just want each one of us to think. Am I on my way to Canaan? Have I been saved? Have I died to the old nature, which is equivalent of the Red Sea? Am I keeping my eyes on Moses or Jesus? Now in our case, who is the beginner and the finisher of my faith? Maybe you have never made that decision. And today you realize that remaining in Egypt means destruction. And you want to say, no, I don't want to sink with the ship. I want to move with the Lord. If you are here and you want to make that commitment, I would like to give you a minute to put your hand up so that we pray with you and help you to get out of Egypt. If you are still in Egypt, stuck in your sins, never confessed them, never been washed by the blood of Jesus, never repented, this is the time. I'm sure many of us have made that decision, but in our walk, we've made challenges, and we've complained, we've grumbled, we've gone back, we've turned back to go back, going back to our old friends, to our old habits, our old sins. Could you be here? You've been a Christian, but a defeated one. And today you want to say no turning back. You can also put your hand up so that I pray with you as I conclude. Determination to walk, no turning back. Just put your hand up. It's okay. It's between you and your God. Because God had them, He hears you. Just put your hand up and say, I want to recommit myself to the Lord. I want to surrender. I want to push off all these things that were turning me back to Egypt. My little daughter, can you stand with your hand up so that I pray with you? Just stand up. And anyone else who has made that decision, who discovered you are not walking right with the Lord, and you made a decision to confess it today and walk with the Lord as expected, you can join her before we pray. Pray this prayer after me. Lord Jesus, I have realized that I have been turning back to Egypt. I have been attracted by little things in my mind, in my heart, and I have sinned against you. Forgive me, Lord. Cleanse me by that blood that you shed on Calvary. Receive me back, Lord. Thank you, Jesus, for receiving me back. Thank you for forgiving me those areas where I had turned back. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen.
Thank you so much, Canon, for accepting God to use you. Friends, let us stand up for the blessing. Almighty God, we commend our life to you, and we ask that enable each one of us to focus on the major things, focus on you, Christ Jesus, and fix our eyes in our daily walks, in the private and the public. Beloved in Jesus Christ, may the Lord bless you and watch over you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord look kindly to you and give you peace. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always. Amen. We'll join the choir in the recessional hymn.